Hello, folks. Oh, no, don't want the acoustic this time. welcome, everyone. It's been ages, hasn't it? How are you? How are you keeping? Well, I hope. Well, we've got some stunning, stunning Schubert to look at this afternoon. And yes, we're a few minutes late starting, those of you watching live, just because that lovely piece we've just learnt, Chor der Engel, took a little bit longer to learn than the half hour, but absolutely worth it. I mean, Schubert himself was a master of every possible element that you could ask for, and we'll be talking about that and much more besides. Now, a little bit of background. I am a huge Schubert nerd. I studied his music at university, down to the finest granular detail. I studied one of his piano works using a technique called Schenkerian analysis, which some of you, if you've studied music, will have heard of. And so I really do appreciate, I feel that, you know, that Schubert is a massively underrated composer and should have been the Mozart of his day. And in many ways he was, but in others he wasn't appreciated until many, many years after his death. And we'll talk about that today. Now, last year, prior to lockdown, I actually delivered here in the UK a six-part course lasting about 2 hours per session on Schubert, and I barely felt I had time to just scratch the surface of his works. And it's going to be even worse today with only half an hour. So what I'm going to ask you all to do is to trust me when I say, if you start listening to Schubert, you won't regret it. His piano works, his choral works, his instrumental works, string quartets, his piano sonatas, his symphonies, his opera, just exquisite. And so of all the composers we've looked at in our great composers series, Schubert is the one that I would say really do go and seek out some Schubert that you don't know. Now, with that in mind, it's lovely to see so many people come across from the choral learning session. Nikki's gone, okay, deal. Fabulous. We're going to make a start, folks, because we're running late. So do enjoy today's session. We're looking at, well, we are going to talk about Schubert's life. We're going to talk about his choral music. But in particular today, I had to choose, of all the wonderful choral pieces that I know and love by Schubert, it's got to be the Mass in A-flat. And I think a couple of you may have heard it and sung it before. But for the vast majority of us, we don't know this work. It's not really in the main major choral repertoire. And there's a number of good reasons for that, mostly because it's a very, very ambitious piece for choirs to learn, and Schubert is still criminally underappreciated. But let's put that to one side and let's make a start. So let's meet the man himself. Here he is, Franz Peter Schubert, another one of these astonishing musicians who showed promise at a very young age. He was born in 1797 in a suburb of Vienna, and he was born 6 years after Mozart died. And a generation after Beethoven's birth. So he was he sort of fits into that period where the Romantic era was very much underway, but not quite as advanced as, you know, the music of Brahms and later Bruckner and Mahler and so on. But he was absolutely instrumental, no pun intended, in the development of the Romantic era, and is a bit like Beethoven. You know, he brought elements of the classical era into the Romantic era, but made them much more human, and more on that later. Now, Schubert's father was a school teacher of relatively modest means, and this is important later on. He wasn't of the upper classes. He was not a wealthy, didn't come from a wealthy family, as a number of composers did. But he displayed a substantial musical talent very, very early on. He could play the violin, he could play the piano. His father made sure he received training in all of the major instrument groups. And it's highly likely, looking at the sketches and the historical records that we have, that Schubert began composing pretty much as soon as he could read music. You know, creativity was just pouring out of him. And his early surviving compositions, and he wrote a fantasy for piano dated from 1810, when he was only 13. So, you know, another one of these great talents from a very young age, prodigious. So here's the house in which Schubert was born. And you can visit these wonderful houses. And Anna and I years ago visited Salzburg, again, another important place in Schubert's life. But in what's really interesting is where these composers' lives that we study, we had a look a few weeks ago, of course, at Mozart. It's interesting how these great composers, how their lives intersected. Because although Mozart died years before Schubert was born, well, Mozart's contemporary and would-be assassin, although of course it wasn't, he didn't do it, Salieri, was a huge, huge influence in Schubert's life. And in 1807, Schubert's father took the then 10-year-old boy for a consultation with Antonio Salieri, who was the imperial Kapellmeister, the master of the imperial chapel. And Salieri recommended that the boy should gain a place in the choir and be given an examination to enter into a music program. He passed the examination with flying colours and joined the choir at the age of 11. And of course, this meant in those days, if you were in the Imperial Chapel Choir, well, that gave you a free education with the academic secondary school, which was associated with the university. So it was a great opportunity for a young lad. And Schubert flourished there. Now, there's an awful lot of information I want to share with you about Schubert's young life. I don't have time today, but do read all about him and his development. His years in the choir were absolutely formative. You know, he was singing choral music at the highest level and taking part in all of the main church services. And it seems that for many of his early years in the chapel choir, he was a devoted and very faithful chorister and really believed very strongly in God and read the Bible a lot. And then something happened in his teens, you know, something changed, and he went from, you know, a full devotion to his holy studies to sort of turning his back on it a little bit. And we'll talk about that more in a moment. But after he completed his basic education, the young Schubert trained to be a school teacher like his father. Now, this might surprise you. You think, well, why didn't he train to be a composer? Well, he did compose. He was composing all the way through, and despite his duties as a young teacher at the age of 17, he was still creating masses and string quartets and compositions for solo piano, and he was still learning with Salieri, who was training him in counterpoint, you know, the art of the fugue. But what happened, it's rather sad, ladies and gentlemen, he fell in love. He fell in love with this lady, Therese Grobe, who was the first and really only love of Schubert's life, and it was a very, very sad tale. They were madly in love with each other, and they wanted to marry. And Schubert approached Grobe's father and asked to marry her, but unfortunately a strict marriage consent law was in place at the time, which expressly forbade men of Schubert's class to marry, and bearing in mind that Therese Grobe was from a rich family. If he couldn't verify his ability to support a family, if he didn't have a decent job, well, then he wasn't allowed to marry a woman of her stature. And so that's why he worked so hard to become a music teacher. He applied for teachers' training college in Slovenia to try and gain some financial security to make marriage to Theresa possible. Unfortunately, it didn't work out, and she ended up marrying someone else and had a very happy life. And Schubert wrote later on, in fact, it was the composer's friend Anselm Huttenbrenner, who I'll introduce to you in just a minute, who wrote of Schubert, a conversation. Schubert had said, "I loved someone very dearly, and she loved me too. For 3 years, she hoped I would marry her, but I couldn't find a position which would have provided for us both." So he wasn't able to get a job that would suitably provide for her. So in the end, he lost her, and she married someone else, and he never married. And although he was always surrounded by women, he was such a popular character with ladies, he himself sort of shied away from them. He was a very nervous, very, very timid character. Here is a little drawing of Anselm Huttenbrenner, the tall chap. He was a man of great stature, a great baritone, and very well connected. And Schubert, who was known as Die Schwammeln, the little mushroom, because he was quite portly, he was very small, and sort of just shrank away into the background. And that really was Schubert's lot in life. He wasn't a grand character, but he was surrounded by people who recognised his talent, including the erstwhile Herr Huttenbrenner. Now, having loved and lost, Schubert threw himself into his composing. You know, he thought, well, what's the point in being a teacher? What he really wanted to do was to compose. So he conducted the first major public performance of his work, his Mass in F major, which was a great success. And he then received his first paid commission for a cantata, Prometheus. And if you've never heard it, it's well worth a listen. It was written when he was only 17, but still a vibrant, really exciting piece. And in 1818, he gave up teaching school completely and turned his energies to music. Now, over the next few years, he tried unsuccessfully to obtain a number of different permanent posts as a composer or a conductor. He received an award from a major Austrian society and was very excited about this and wrote them a particularly nice piece until he found out that the award had no money, had no monetary value at all. And although it looked good on his CV, effectively, it wasn't actually going to pay his bills. So what Schubert threw himself into was composing music for the salon, for people's living rooms, effectively. And you must bear in mind that at this time in history, there was a huge upswell and huge interest in music to be played at home. There was a rising middle class who could afford to buy a piano for the house. And pianos by this time were being mass produced. We're talking about the Industrial Revolution in full swing. And so, you know, the 19th century saw this huge growth. I mean, enormous, just massive growth in pianos all around the world. And therefore, if you have all these instruments, well, you need music to play on them. And so Schubert found a market for his lovely, lovely songs. Gretchen am Spinnrader, Gretchen at the Spinning Wheel, is one of his earliest ones, which actually made him some money. And at his peak, he was writing up to 8 songs a day. I mean, fully composed songs, which he was then able to sell. And eventually, you know, he was paid relatively well. So he's in his mid-20s. Paid relatively well for his work and found himself at the heart of this sort of Austrian society where, you know, his rich friends would invite him to come and would play. And bearing in mind, these are the days, obviously, before recorded sound. If you wanted to have a party, well, you'd want to have a good musician in the corner playing. Schubert filled that role beautifully. Although, as I said, despite all sorts of attention from ladies who were fawning over him, he never really fell in love with anyone else after Therese. Now, a lot of his circles of friends were bohemians and artists and intellects and poets and musicians and philosophers, and he found himself very much at the heart of the burgeoning Romantic movement. But sadly, and it always comes to this, in 1823, at the age of only 26, Schubert began to suffer the first signs of ill health and was hospitalized for treatment of syphilis. And for a man who basically was so shy around women, it's just so awful that he had love within his grasp so young, and by losing that love, it doomed him to an early death. Although he continued to be part of the Viennese musical scene for several years, for the next 5 years really, he suffered from intermittent bouts of severe ill health and became more and more prone to fits of depression and melancholy. And you can hear that in his music. It's very interesting to note that, you know, those composers that live a long life, a bit like artists, they have their young period and their middle period and their older period. Beethoven definitely has 3 ages. Well, Schubert had that as well, but very much compressed into his 32 and a bit years. So we have these later works that were produced in the last 5 years of Schubert's life, which are very much obsessed with death. If you look at his great song cycles, the Schöne Marin, the beautiful Miller Girl, and Die Winterreise, they're both absolutely glorious, but at their heart you have an obsession almost with death. And the last movement of Die Winterreise, the Hurdy-Gurdy Man, is just so spine-tingling. Just talking to you about it now, the hair's up on the back of my neck, just thinking about it. Listen to the last movement of Der Leiermann, it's called. And it is just so haunting and just so powerful from the works of a young man who knew that his days were numbered. And he died in November 1828, just a few months short of his 32nd birthday. And even throughout this difficult time, he never stopped composing. One of the last pieces he produced was a piano sonata, in B flat major, which is one of the greatest piano works ever written. And it has this beautiful, beautiful theme, but at the heart of it, there's a deep bass rumble that just suggests trouble on the horizon. It's the last piece he composed. And when he died, he left more than 1,200 works, ladies and gentlemen, an enormous body of work, you know, that would dwarf many of the composers who lived full and healthy lives, including over 600 songs, 9 symphonies, 15 string quartets, and numerous piano pieces. And, you know, really, we have to wonder, a bit like with Mozart and with Purcell and these great composers who left us so young, what would music today sound like if he'd lived just another 10 years? Having said that, as I said at the start, we're just so lucky that he did live as long as he did and produce the works that he did. So let's turn our attention to this great choral work that I've been going on about since we started, this Mass in A flat major. Now, although Schubert's best known for his Lieder, his songs, he wrote many sacred works as well. And as I've already said, he had an interesting relationship with the church. I think he had a profound faith throughout his life. In fact, he still wrote later on in his life. He wrote to his father, and we'll talk about that in a minute. But what I think he found it difficult to accept was authority, particularly that of the church. I wonder if he had a difficult time in the imperial choir, if there were particularly nasty masters and priests who treated him badly. And interestingly, his anti-ecclesiastical views are demonstrated by his refusal to include in the credo, in the creed, which is an essential part of the Mass, et unum sanctum catholicam et apostolicam ecclesiam, I believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic church. He didn't include any of those words in his Masses. So there's very much a sort of sense of he was writing sacred works, but very much on his own terms. And but as I've said, despite his antipathy towards the church, Schubert was a spiritual man. And as he wrote in a letter to his father, he said, I've never forced myself to piety. I never compose hymns or prayers of that kind unless it takes me unawares. But then it's usually the right and true piety. He didn't set out to deliberately write sacred music, but when he felt moved to, he did. And that brings us to the Mass in A flat, which in itself is a huge work. It's monolithic. He referred to it as his Missa Solemnis. And just to quickly remind you folks that there are two types of Mass setting. Usually you have the Missa Brevis, the short Mass, and then you have the Missa Solemnis, which is a full sort of setting of the Mass and usually lasts quite a while. Beethoven's Missa Solemnis is a huge undertaking for any choir. And this is of the same sort of stature. Now, the movements are 10, 15 minutes each. They are hugely demanding. They require the very best singers, the very best orchestral players. And interestingly, this particular Mass setting was very important to Schubert. We know that because he kept coming back to it. You know, he started writing it in 1819, but didn't finish it until September of 1822. And that, for Schubert, is a long, long period of time. You know, for him to keep coming back to it again and again, for a man who would produce 8 songs in one day. And we believe that he spent more time reworking the Mass in A-flat than any other work in the 1,200 pieces that he produced. And he then revised it one more time in 1826 in support of an unsuccessful application for the post of the Deputy Imperial Kapellmeister. You know, basically a job interview, polished it up. Sadly, didn't get in the job, but we're lucky enough to have this work to listen to. So let's listen to a bit of it. And we're going to have time to listen to just two contrasting movements today. We're going to listen to bits of the Kyrie and the Gloria. And what I love about both of these works is that it shows Schubert at his best in terms of storytelling. Schubert was, unlike some of the other great composers who were, you know, masters at one or two elements of music, but perhaps not so great at others. And at this point, I've got to be careful, but Beethoven, marvellous composer as he was, wasn't a brilliant writer of melody. Sorry, but he wasn't. You know, he wrote capsules, he wrote short, sharp stuff. He was brilliant at drama, but his melodies sometimes left a little bit to be desired. Schubert was a master of melody. And texture and orchestration and counterpoint and everything else. And he includes all of this in his Mass in A-flat. So the Kyrie opens in the beautiful, soft, gentle key of A-flat major. And Kyrie eleison, Lord have mercy. Christe eleison, Christ have mercy. The entire movement is begging for mercy, begging for forgiveness with this lovely, lovely lilting sound. Let's have a little bit of this. And so we'll start at the beginning and you'll hear this beautiful plaintive line played by the instruments and the choir coming in very softly. And then there are interludes for solo voice, very operatic. Here we are, everyone. Here is a bit of the Kyrie from the Mass in A flat. Just so lovely, everyone. Okay, so now what we have is a little period of interludes as we move from this idea of Kyrie eleison to Christe eleison, and we have this lovely solo section sung by the soprano initially and then echoed by the tenor. Let's have a listen to this. This lovely chord here. Another tenor. Just so beautiful and plaintive. That chord is reaching out as if up to heaven to beg for forgiveness. And Schubert, being the master of composition that he was, you know, always made sure if he introduced some material, he would reuse it, but he'd present it in a different way next time. Absolutely beautiful. I'm going to skip to the end of this lovely movement, which is really well worth enjoying. There's the most incredible a cappella moment in the end of this, where the choir sings Kyrie eleison, eleison, and what follows is just staggering. The bass is holding a pedal note while there's just a series of intense clashes over the top. So let's have a little bit of this before we move to the Gloria. Here we go. Okay, now this is heading back to the end. Now here. Isn't that just so lovely? And now, one more time. Darkness to light, back to darkness again. Now to lightness. And then just like a pastoral symphony, gentle, going to sleep almost. Oh, so beautifully set. A simple chord, but with those chromatic notes just colouring them slightly. Now, we finish in A flat major. Now, those of you who've been on my my round sound course will have noted that E major is as far away from A flat as you can get, and that's where he starts the glory. We finish in A flat, you then have to come straight in E major, which is a huge, bright key, and it's a lot louder. Let's have a little bit of the glory as a total contrast. And this is rather an epic movement, so we're going to have to jump through this one as well. But here is the glory that follows straight on from that. No chord, no preparation. The choir have to come straight in. It's loud. Here we go. And then contrast. And in earth peace, et in terra pax hominibus. Okay, Laudamus Te, we praise thee, we bless thee. Big stuff now. Fabulous, absolutely fabulous. We will hear some more. I'm going to skip on because there's lots more sort of interaction between the choir and soloists now. And contrast, you notice, really quiet followed by really loud. You know, these big 19th century dynamic contrasts, you know, being used to great effect. Now, there's a middle section here where we have this beautiful, beautiful interlude. Domine Deus Agnus Dei, no, Gratias Agimus, this is all very sweet, but we're going to skip this, and get to the Domine Deus Agnus Dei, which is an absolutely fabulous, fabulous little section. Here we go. So, Domine Deus Agnus Dei, Lord God, Lamb of God. Here we go. So, this is where it gets darker again. And this beautiful line on the clarinet. Schubert's melody writing coming forward, bassooned contrast. And then the bass takes up the tune. Here come the choir again. And that lovely tune now, oboe. And bassoon again. And the tenor now in the minor. So you can hear Schubert is a master at introducing an idea and reusing it, but in different configurations. Sometimes it's the major, sometimes it's the minor. So it's always familiar, but it's different every time it comes back. Now, just to finish for today, folks, I'm going to play you a little bit of this wonderful, wonderful section here where the choir come in towards the end of the Gloria. Here we go. Enjoy. It's building to something. to this. So it's a good old-fashioned fugue in the style of Haydn and Mozart and Beethoven. And so what we see here, I'm sorry to have to pause it and to stop it here, everyone, because there's still another 4 minutes of fugue. And bearing in mind, this is just the second movement of a multi-movement mass with a Creed and a Sanctus and a Benedictus and an Agnus Dei still to go. This is the mastery of Schubert, who really, as I've said, I feel is criminally underrepresented in the pantheon of classical music. We know him for the Trout, and for Death and the Maiden and a few other works, but actually his genius is far flung across the entire canon, and I really can't recommend the Mass in A-flat highly enough to you. As you've seen here, you can download versions or look at versions on YouTube that have full score all the way through if you'd rather just sit back and let the sound wash over you. The Credo is astonishing, the Sanctus is gorgeous, the Agnus Dei will make you cry, and that's just one of the 1,200 plus works that Schubert left behind him. And it's very, very telling that on his gravestone, it said, to paraphrase, here lies the body of a man, but even greater hopes. You know, the people who knew him knew when he died just what the world had lost. And in fact, when Schumann, his friend, was going through a chest full of Schubert's music, you know, he came across the sketches of the Great Symphony, and he said, you know, I've found the greatest work ever written. And Mendelssohn was an enormous fan and follower of Schubert. And in fact, even Beethoven, when he died, you know, he knew that Schubert was one of the absolute greats and requested one of Schubert's string quartets to be played for him as he lay dying. And in fact, Schubert was one of the pallbearers at Beethoven's funeral. That's how important he is. So if I can recommend to you that you get to know the works of this great man, even better, starting with the Mass in A-flat, and then just follow your own trail, ladies and gentlemen, through his lovely, lovely music. And I think one day soon I'll have to do a longer session on him, because my goodness me, what a genius. Now look, I have overrun by quite a long way, and thank you everyone for your patience. I do hope you've enjoyed our deep dive today, a bit deeper than usual, and I look forward to seeing you on Friday for our next session. Just to warn you, it's going to be slightly gross. We're going to sing Worms and a whole load of other songs that have nothing at all to do with this great man here, but are going to be a lot of fun. So I do hope you've enjoyed today. Look forward to seeing you very soon. All the very best, folks. Take care. Bye-bye.